Hello, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you for standing by. Welcome to today's web seminar, Dechert Coffee Break ERISA, What Hedge Fund Managers Need to Know. During the presentation, all participants' line will be in the listen-only mode. Feel free to write your question anytime by using the Q&A window located on the right side of your screen. Type your question in the box and at the bottom and click the send button. Without further delay, I now hand over the floor to Carl. Thank you, and over to you.
Of this series is to present just short 30-minute, very high-level discussions of topics that are of interest to hedge fund managers. The idea behind this is, well, sometimes lawyers can be a little long-winded, and maybe this has something to do with the fact that we charge by the hour. So in this coffee break, we will aim to give you kind of the best, quickest explanation of what goes on with ERISA and what hedge fund managers really need to know. And with that, I'm going to introduce my partner, Andrew Oringer. Drew, you don't mind being called Drew, right?
That's correct.
All right, so Drew Oringer. And Drew is really one of our top-level experts in ERISA. And, you know, the fact is, over the past couple of years, as it's been getting harder and harder to raise hedge fund assets and private fund assets generally, but through this time, we do see an awful lot of activity from U.S. pension funds, from ERISA funds. So just to start with kind of a basic question, what is ERISA and why are we talking about it?
Yeah, thanks, Carl. I mean, most basically ERISA is the U.S. law that really comprehensively regulates private employee benefit plans. It's an extremely extensive statute. I do want to mention that there are some background materials that we posted to the webinar's website that can be helpful, you know, if you really want to get into the weeds on some of these issues. And I guess just before going on, I do want to take a couple of steps back. Carl's already mentioned that, you know, money really in the market is coming from ERISA plans. Now, what does that mean? I mean, this is sort of the reason to talk about ERISA. I mean, a lot of you already who have dialed in realize this, but basically so much of the available investment capital in the world is in pension plans that are governed by ERISA. The money grows tax-free, so it's growing faster than other money. One of the old NBC white papers referred to ERISA investment capital as the biggest lump of money in the world. And I think that really the days of wanting to avoid taking in ERISA money because the statute is so complicated, I think those days are gone. I mean, the fact of the matter is that it's just too much money to turn your back on at this point. I mean, when you're doing a deal and somebody says, hey, Company X is in this deal, Company X is an investor, almost always, maybe even always, what they're talking about is the Company X pension plan, not Company X. That's where the money comes
from. I just want to say, like, that matches up exactly with what we've been seeing in Asia, that there are managers that 5 years ago said, look, I want nothing to do with U.S. investors, and especially not those ERISA plans. But those managers are now SEC registered and they're taking on this money. So that matches up exactly with what we're seeing.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, I mean, there's two levels sort of where you can bring in ERISA money. You could bring in ERISA money and just decide you really want to be an ERISA manager. Or you could bring in enough ERISA money that's just short of some limits, and we'll talk about these later, where the money comes in, but you actually don't really expose yourself to being subject to ERISA. But all of these things require some familiarity with the rules so that you can bring in the money in the way you want to. And as I said before, the days of where you could just say, eh, you know what, that's a very complicated statute, I'm not interested in learning it. You can do that, but it really is going to require you to turn your back on a heck of a lot of investment capital.
All right. Now, that said, the rules still are they're kind of a handful. There's a lot of money, but it is money that seems to come with conditions. little bit like your allowance when your parents are first trying to give you money, but you have to do some chores. And ERISA's chores are pretty serious. But there are ways around it. How do you avoid the full application of ERISA if you're a fund manager?
Yeah, I mean, let's start with funds as opposed to separately managed accounts. In the case of a separately managed account, I'm not sure it's going to be so easy to avoid ERISA, but let's start with funds. The big issue here in a lot of cases, as you're sort of indicating, is that the fund manager really doesn't want to be subject to ERISA. I mean, ERISA is complicated, very potentially risky, and you can understand why it might be nice to avoid it. So before we get into how to avoid it, let's first understand how it is that you could ever become an ERISA fiduciary by just taking money into your fund. And here I like to go through an example, a very simple, stark example. So let's say you have a pension plan, and the pension fund comes to you, and the pension fund wants to drop all of its assets, 100%. They just want to drop all of its assets into some kind of a holding company. You just you know, forget about your own investment fund for the moment and just imagine this example. So they drop all their money into a subsidiary of the pension fund, and then they say something along the lines of, hey, let's take back 10 shares of this holding company, and let's take the position that all the plan has is 10 shares of the holding company, and that all of the billions of dollars of the plan's assets, those are just assets owned by Holdco, by this holding company. Those aren't really subject to ERISA. Well, that would really be too easy, right? If a plan could just move all of its money into a holding company and then say that all of the assets in the holding company aren't subject to ERISA, it would sort of be too good to be true. And sure enough, it is too good to be true. So what the Department of Labor has done here, which is the agency that administers ERISA, what they've done is they've come up with a rule. And the rule is that when a plan makes an equity investment in another entity, like, for example, your investment fund, then the plan's assets for ERISA purposes include all of the assets of that fund. So that would make your investment fund into plan assets really just like those assets were still held in the pension trust, which obviously would make you then a fiduciary, unless an exception applies. So that's a big point, right? The big point is that if you don't have an exception, then when you take an equity investment into your fund from a pension fund, you're essentially subjecting yourself to ERISA. And what is the exception that you tend to see? The exception that you tend to see is that if you limit ERISA investment to being less than 25% of each class of equity of the investment fund, then what the rules say is that the fund itself is not subject to ERISA. And so by doing that, you will have taken ERISA assets into your fund, but you will not have caused the fund itself to become subject to ERISA. And the key there is that less than 25% of every class of equity of the fund has to be held by an ERISA plan. And just before we leave this point, just if anybody of you have heard this, there is another exception out there. It's called venture capital operating companies, the VCOC exception. I'm not going to get into that in any detail. That's for private equity. That's where you have a fund that's taking an active role in the management of operating companies. If you've got a private equity fund, you may have seen the phrase venture capital operating company or VCOC, but let's not confuse. This is only a little bit of time we have to talk to you. Let's sort of forget that for the moment. The real exception, assuming you're not private equity, is the 25% exception, and that's where when you keep more than 25%, when you make it be that less than 25% of every class of equity of your fund is held by ERISA plans, then you can take the money in, and it does not subject the fund to ERISA, and it does not cause the fiduciaries of the fund to be considered ERISA fiduciaries. Carl, did that sort of address that basic threshold question?
Yeah, I think it does. One of the twists, though, that I see from time to time is people talk about the 25% test and hardwiring. What is this, electronics, engineering? I mean, what's the 25% test if you hardwire?
Yeah. So again, that's a great example and a great question. This only really applies, first of all, in a master feeder structure. Okay? If you're talking about a standalone fund, then you're just simply going to be wanting, assuming you don't want to be subject to ERISA, you're going to be wanting to limit your ERISA investment to 25%. That's just the basic rule. But what if you've got a master feeder situation and you've got a situation where some of the feeders may go over the 25% level? And so you're saying, uh-oh, he just told me we want to be under 25%. Okay? The nuance here is that if you set up the feeder so that what we like to call it is, this is not a technical term, it's just sort of what the market started to call it. If you hardwire the feeder into the master, which basically means that the feeder can do nothing other than invest in the master, then what the market says is, generally speaking, the feeder may go over 25%, but if in the aggregate, looking at all the feeders and the master, if the master is under 25%, if the whole circle is under 25%, then that's still okay. Now, at the feeder level where you go over 25%, ERISA will apply. That's sort of the bad news for the moment. The good news is that the requirements at the feeder level are pretty manageable at that point, because what you've done by hardwiring the feeder into the master is you've essentially taken all the discretion out of the feeder, and you've only left yourself with some ancillary rules, things like bonding, things like custody, things like reporting. And basically, those are manageable. And you might say to yourself, well, why do I even want to undertake those requirements? Don't I want to keep away from ERISA altogether? Well, that's going to circle you back to the first point. Yeah, you can keep everything under 25%, but what you're going to be faced with then, if you try to do that, particularly with feeders that are all split up all over the place, is you're going to find yourself turning your back on substantial amounts of investment capital. And that's often not a good thing. So if you are willing and if you can let the feeder go over 25% and then you hardwire the feeder into the master, that's a way of taking in more ERISA investment and still trying to keep the ultimate master under the 25%, so you're not a real ERISA fiduciary.
So it kind of goes back to the fundamental dilemma of life, balancing freedom and the need for more cash.
Yeah.
So I guess we've already talked about the 25% test there. What happens though if you can't comply with the 25% test? You know, hardwiring might give you a little bit of extra headroom, but there have still got to be cases where you go over and you decide, hey, I'm just going to be an ERISA fiduciary. Hey, what's that actually mean?
All right, so let's talk about this. This can happen in two ways, right? This can happen if you accidentally go over the 25% limit and don't mean to, and we'll sort of talk about that a little bit later. But it can also happen where you say, hey, you know what? Not only am I willing to entertain bringing in ERISA investment up to the 25% level, but there's just way too many ERISA investors on my radar. I need to go over the 25% for real. I need to allow myself to be subject to ERISA completely because I do not want to turn my back on this money, that sort of balancing that you were just talking about, Carl. And so what does that mean? Well, the first thing you need to do if you decide that you want to entertain going over 25% is you need, at the master, is that you need to make sure that your fund structure, what you're investing in, the fee structures, all of that, you need to make sure you can handle it. Common examples of funds that may be more likely to actually work under ERISA are, let's say, a simple long equity hedge fund with a simple straightforward fee structure. And another example is a fund of funds. These are relatively simple structures from an ERISA perspective where you sort of can, theoretically at least, allow yourself to be subject to ERISA. Now, once you've gotten comfortable that your fund can operate as an ERISA-governed fund and you want to consider going forward as an ERISA fiduciary, I would really want to caution you. It's really not as simple as what do I have to do or what boxes do I need to check. You really need to understand that the fiduciary aspect of the relationship under ERISA is very fundamental. It requires like a top-down understanding of what it means to be a fiduciary. I mean, the basic standard is that of a prudent expert, which is, to me, a careful, informed manager or advisor that's avoiding negligence with, you know, sort of careful procedures, procedural prudence, as they say.
Okay, can I stop you right there for a second?
Absolutely.
So, I mean, everybody's a fiduciary. You know, every manager is a fiduciary, even if you're in the Cayman Islands. Is this like a supercharged fiduciary? How is this different than just being a normal fiduciary?
Yeah, that's the perfect question. That's a great segue into the next thing I wanted to hit, which is the conflicts of interest. What you could see under other regulatory regimes are conflicts of interest that are waivable or that you can make go away by notice. These conflicts of interest in the ERISA case really may just be flat-out non-starters. Common self-dealing issues can involve prohibitions on cross-trading. They can involve gift and entertainment policies. They can involve really anything that involves even a tinge of self-interest. And while you might be used to regimes where you can notice that away or get consent to that away, what you'll find in ERISA is that when you have conflicts of interest and you have potential self-dealing, you really are handcuffed. You really aren't going to be able to move. And there are times where when you have a self-dealing issue that everybody wants to proceed in a certain way. Take the cross-trading case where you can just save on brokerage expenses. The investor might say, please go ahead, do cross-trades. And the manager might say, we want to do cross-trades. We want to save you brokerage. Everybody might agree. And yet the result might be under ERISA that you just can't. Again, because these things are inflexible, not susceptible to cure by notice and by consent. Another point that I just want to hit really briefly that sometimes gets people quite concerned is that when you do have a breach of fiduciary duty, ERISA says you will be liable to your pension plan client. Now, in a lot of cases, the commercial deal is that, hey, I'm going to be okay unless I'm grossly negligent. You often see that phrase, not liable unless there's gross negligence, or indemnified for everything unless there's gross negligence. Even if the parties are willing to agree to that, ERISA will convert that into a negligence standard. Under ERISA, if you are negligent, you cannot escape potential liability to your client. You may be able to be insured for it or something like that, but the basic liability standard will be that of negligence, and you really can't change that even with the agreement of the pension investor.
All right. Well, I think we've talked a little bit about the stakes of what it means to be subject to ERISA, but I think for a lot of the managers that I advise in Hong Kong and Singapore, the nightmare scenario is it happens on accident. You know, you have a bunch of redemptions from some other investor that's not an ERISA investor, and because of those redemptions, the ERISA investor now owns 26% of the fund. So, you know, what should people be doing in this kind of a situation other than quitting the industry?
Yeah, I mean, this is a very serious issue. People definitely need to take compliance with the 25% test very seriously. It is extremely hard sort of to accidentally satisfy ERISA. If you thought you were under 25% and you wind up going over, the likelihood of just falling into compliance with ERISA is remote. And so assuming that you go over 25 by accident, you know, how bad is it? How serious should we take it? And the answer is seriously. You'll have potential related party problems. If you engage in a prohibited related party transaction, what you may find is that you're essentially effectively insuring the transactions that you do. So you accidentally now are over ERISA, you're an ERISA fiduciary, and you accidentally have related party transactions, you could be liable for any downturns. Also, your counterparties, they may get hit with excise taxes. they're not going to be happy about that. There's real relationship issues there. And by the way, that's a reason that as you're working through these issues, you're going to find yourself, generally speaking, agreeing with your financial counterparties that you won't go over the 25% limit. And so one aspect there is that you may find yourself in breach of your contractual obligations under ISDA's prime brokerage agreements and the like to your financial counterparties.
Fantastic. That really does sound like a nightmare scenario. But I mean, to go back a little bit to the related parties, who are these related parties? I mean, do you know who your related parties are? Normally, I think you would, but I think ERISA's definition of related party is a little trickier than that.
Yeah, it's one of the places where ERISA is extremely broad. So to a pension plan, a related party includes the people you might expect. The plan sponsor, if Company X sponsors the plan, Company X is a related party. Well, that makes sense. The fiduciaries to the plan are related parties, the managers and the trustees and the like. Again, these things make sense, but here's where it catches you, and here's where it gets very broad. Related party includes a mere service provider to the pension plan, a mere service provider. So all of the pension plan's brokers, even if they have nothing to do with the assets you're managing, they're all related parties. Essentially, every financial institution in the world, which is providing services to virtually every plan in the world, is basically a related party to every plan. And so now all of a sudden, you're unable to proceed with all of these financial institutions and other related parties unless you've got an exemption. And again, all these things are manageable if you know what the issue is and if you know what you need to be doing and if you qualify for the exceptions and exemptions. But if you accidentally slip into it, what's the likelihood that you're going to possibly comply with these kind of broad rules, which, again, to make this point, treat mere brokers and other service providers as related parties to plans, just like the employer that sponsors the plan is a related party to the plan?
It really sounds like you'd be up a malodorous creek without a paddle. Some of my clients, there's always one that will ask, yeah, but how am I going to get caught? How will anybody find out about this? What's the answer to that? I mean, how is this enforced?
Yeah, and let's just give one more sort of piece of background and then go right into that just to show how tentacle-like this can get. Don't forget, you might be investing downstream in, let's say, another entity or another fund, and maybe it's running a 25% test, right? And now all of a sudden it turns out that you've told them that you're not subject to ERISA, but you are. So now their 25% test is contaminated. So now there's another whole population that might be gunning for you because they've got this issue. And also bear in mind that there's no grace period here. If you're over the 25% test, then there's no real ways to fix it. So how could this come up? Okay, well, you could have other people in the market sort of getting wind of this or wondering about it and maybe inquiring. What's another way this could come up? Your investors, sometimes themselves, pension plans are very compliance-oriented. They may be asking questions. What about the Department of Labor? We mentioned them as administering ERISA. They might be doing a random audit, and they might catch you that way. And then, to me, the main way that this can happen, your investments turn down. You're losing money. I mean, I know that that can't happen to any of the people on this call, but for other people that aren't calling in, their funds may experience a downturn, and if they do, those investors are going to look for deep pockets, and they're going to look for ways in which they can make claims. And one way is for them to raise their hand and say, huh, is there any possibility that ERISA applies here, and all of those ERISA protections get to me? And now all of a sudden, instead of just having a downturn and people crabbing about, oh, I can't believe the assets have turned down, you now have people potentially raising their hands and say, hey, I think there are some legal violations, and I'm entitled to redress. And I think that is actually probably of all these things. I mean, the random audit is pretty risky, but the downturn scenario where people are looking for excuses to come after you, that one really scares me.
All right, so that's what it is. So if you have deep pockets, make sure they're in blue jeans. They're awfully tight because it's hard for people to get their hands in them. What's going on? with ERISA. Is there anything new, anything else coming up on the horizon? I mean, a lot of this stuff has been the law of the land for a while.
Yeah, I mean, I think things are pretty stable. I think the market, you know, there's not a lot of law on a lot of this, but the market develops some points of view. There's not a whole lot that's brand new, with one exception. The big news is, you may have heard that there are these soon-to-be-released fiduciary regulations, the regulations that define what investment advice is. Now, this is where the Department of Labor, the DOL, has sought to bring non-discretionary consultants and advisors under the fiduciary tent and thereby subject them to fiduciary responsibilities and potential liabilities. Very controversial. It spawned thousands of comment letters, quite literally. They had to withdraw them once. They repropose them. The President of the United States has gotten involved in this, believe it or not. This is the real deal, but it's non-discretionary. So you might be saying to yourself out there, well, wait a minute, I'm a discretionary manager, why do I care? And the answer is that in your capacity as a discretionary manager, you probably don't care, because as a discretionary manager, you're either already an ERISA fiduciary or you're satisfying the 25% test. And these new rules wouldn't change that. The place where it might affect you, though, believe it or not, is that the way the Department of Labor appears to be expanding this stuff, they're apparently going to reach things like sales and marketing. Mere sales and marketing activities may now become fiduciary activities. That's new. And so what that's going to mean, if this thing gets finalized, which is definitely expected, is that your regular sort of vanilla sales and marketing efforts to U.S. pension plans will now involve another layer of regulation and will now involve presumably some risk assessment and some I-dotting and some T-crossing. My guess is that if you do everything right, it should all still be fine. Point here is that there'll be more to do right, and so there'll be more questions to ask. It's very unfortunate that they've sought here to go after what I'll call vanilla sales and marketing, but it really reflects their mistrust of the financial services industry, and so that looks to be like where we're heading. Again, I don't believe it's going to mean in the lion's share of cases that sales and marketing activities have to stop or anything like that, but I do believe that there'll be a new layer of compliance activity that needs to follow the sales and marketing efforts.
Okay, Drew. I promised everybody we'd keep it short and sweet, so I'm going to ask if any attendees have any questions they'd like to ask. Please just input them into the Q&A box on the lower right-hand side of the web event center. But Drew, I mean, just kind of going back and while we wait to see if there are any questions, would this new fiduciary rule have any impact outside the U.S.? Is it, would it affect Asian hedge fund managers, or is it really just a U.S. thing?
No, I think it's quite extraterritorial to the extent that the Asian manager seeks to access the U.S. pension money. So if the Asian manager makes an effort, let's say, to attract the capital of the X company pension plan, and if it does so in a way that doesn't satisfy the new rules, then there could be fiduciary breaches. There could be potential reputational issues. There could be potential relationship issues. There could be potential actual real liability. Now, you might say, look, how are you really going to get jurisdiction over me? How are you going to reach outside the U.S. and really come after me for selling to a pension plan? And the answer I always give on that is I'm always very nervous about relying on a jurisdictional link or the lack of a jurisdictional link to bail me out. If I've got a substantive legal problem and I'm going to be relying on the fact that you can't get to me, that makes me nervous. And so I think the better result for those managers that are really looking to access the U.S. market is to look at what it is that they do and don't have to do and to ramp up on the compliance side. I think you want to be in compliance. I don't think you want to be relying on the argument that the U.S. authorities just simply can't reach you.
All right. So let's count on the long arm of the Department of Labor.
Oh, we have a question.
Right.
Okay, so, I mean, Carl, I can look at that. Okay, so we have a question from the audience, which is that I had mentioned that a long-only fund is fairly straightforward. What about a hedge fund? again, I think that to the extent that the hedge fund is, you know, essentially dealing, and a lot of them I think might be long only, but I think that to the extent that the hedge fund, and Carl, I'll look for color from you after I've had a go at this. If the hedge fund is really dealing mostly with, let's say, publicly traded securities, if you're not talking about private deals, if you're not talking about private equity, and if the fee structure is, you know, what I'll call a fairly standard, like sort of an NAV type mark-to-market fee structure based on realized and unrealized gains, that's the kind of scenario that really does lend itself to a fairly clear path of ERISA compliance. It's where you're starting to talk about like private equity carry type structures on the fees, where you're talking about privately negotiated transactions where you know who your counterparty is and you might be walking into prohibited transactions with related parties and the like. Those are where it gets more complicated. None of this is necessarily undoable, but I was just trying to give examples of where the path is most clear, sort of the very straightforward, you know, hedge fund or long-only fund, or the very straightforward fund of funds. It doesn't mean that other things are not doable. I was just trying to give those examples of where you tend to see people willing to go over and be subject to ERISA. Carl,
that's exactly it. You know, in Asia, we see an awful lot of Asia long-short funds, but the last year or so, we have seen some interesting hybrid structures. We've seen credit structures.
Right.
You know, there are all kinds of things that are popping up in Hong Kong now that we didn't see a few years ago. And, you know, we've worked on these things. And, you know, these are all managers that are getting pretty sizable commitments from ERISA investors. So we figured out ways to make it work.
Yeah, we've done some credit stuff. I mean, it's tricky. You need a manager that can really, you know, sort of deal with the extra quantum of risk where it's a little bit more complex. Some of these funds, though, I will say there will be fund structures where it really is hard to go forward as an ERISA fiduciary. So it really needs to be looked at on a case-by-case basis. And more fund structures, more and more fund types are doing this. Again, I don't want to be a broken record. Why? Why do they keep on trying this? And why do they keep on pushing the envelope? Because they don't want to turn back in investment capital because they don't want to be stuck at the 25% level. They want the money. And you can understand that. I mean, that makes perfect sense.
Well, in Jerry Maguire, they said it best, show me the money.
Show me the money.
That is all the time we have today, but actually I'm going to forward on from my photo there to Drew's. If you have any questions about ERISA, ask Drew. If you have any questions about money, just give me a call. We do this pretty much every month, the Coffee Break series. Again, we aim to give you a very succinct, high-level discussion in 30 minutes. Let us know if there's any topics that you'd like us to cover in future editions, and let us know if you like this format and you think it's useful. On that note, I want to say thanks to everybody who's attended and thanks to everybody who helped put this together. We'll see you next month. I'll be talking with Tim Spangler, who's a private funds partner in our Southern California office, about the SEC's enforcement priorities and how they might affect hedge fund managers and private fund managers outside the U.S. Thanks so much. Good morning, and talk to you all next month. Bye-bye.
Thank you all. This concludes today's conference call. Thank you for your participation. You may now disconnect your lines. Thank you. Have a nice day.